For those of you who haven't heard the term functional and access needs, we used to have special needs populations, vulnerable needs populations. There were so many ways of describing vulnerable persons. And in the last few years, the Department for Homeland Security has determined their definition and called it functional and access needs populations. At the same time, the CDC took some of that definition and added a bit more. And I want to talk a bit about comparing the definitions because I think it's valuable from whatever point of view you are addressing this issue. The Kentucky Functional and Access Needs definition combines the CDC with the FEMA and Homeland Security definition. These are individuals with needs that necessitate assistance before, during, and after an emergency and are considered to be at risk. Historically, this would include anybody who had any type of transportation issues, whether it's in evacuation, getting to a shelter, getting to a safe place. We're now looking at assistance from the scope of not just during an event, but prior to, during, and after the event. At-risk individuals may have disabilities, limited language proficiency, and medical disorders that affect their ability to effectively navigate a disaster. And I could underscore the word navigate. Persons with functional or access needs may be illiterate, transient, transportation disadvantaged, pharmacologically dependent, and include children, older persons, and pregnant women. They can have needs in communication, medical intervention, independence maintained with assistance, supervision, and transportation. I want to talk about our results from a series of focus groups that we did a number of years ago with older persons, not just functional and access needs individuals, but a wide range of categories of older persons. And these tend to be generic concerns. They worry about how are they going to be notified about an emergency? How will they maintain their independence? Many have chronic health issues. Quite a few have multiple chronic health issues. How will they get access to medications? Many deal with isolation, or their family members are concerned about older persons with isolation issues, mobility, memory issues. They're also more sensitive to sensory changes. Comorbid mental health issues. I would also incorporate substance abuse in there. Transportation issues, financial limitations is a big concern, especially during the recovery phase. Also, we find, as well as in the response phase, when others in the community have gone to community shelters, and we find that a lot of older persons would prefer to stay home so that they can, quote, guard their property. And then the bureaucracy, if they needed assistance in the recovery phase, of how they would deal with the FEMA regulations. Not only were we able to identify concerns of older persons, in speaking to many, many community-based agencies, we were able to capture their concerns as well. Who's in charge? Line of command is a big issue, especially if you're an agency. And why am I talking about agencies, as well as functional and access needs? Well, functional and access needs populations need the support of agency staff, agency membership or eligibility. And if the agencies aren't taken care of, then they won't be able to support the individuals in the population of functional and access needs. So we've got, in a way, two customers here. We've got the functional and access needs population, and we have the population of those that support and respond to the functional and access needs population. And just for brevity, we call it FAN in Kentucky, functional and access needs. So I'm going to address it as FAN through the rest of the presentation. How much emergency support is there? How do they make a decision whether to shelter in place or evacuate? And what are the ramifications for an agency if they do either? How will they secure supplies and equipment? What might their transportation needs be in terms of their staff being able to respond to their customers or their clients if there's debris in the road or there are barriers to staff being able to get to their assigned clients? What about heating and cooling issues? Sheltering issues for the FAN population, which we'll spend quite a bit of time on. Staffing, financially, from an interruption of services point of view, how do they recoup expenses during a disaster, especially if they've gone beyond their normal scope of effort with their clients? And all of that, in essence, wraps into continuity of operations and planning for continuity of operations. Older persons are at high risk in an emergency because they can experience an altered immune function from the stress as well as from exposure to environmental conditions. They're at higher risk for infectious illnesses, have a reduced response to antibiotics, and may have atypical presentation of a disease compared to the rest of a population, especially if we're talking about a shelter situation. As I've said earlier, multiple chronic medical conditions. I find it staggering that they're at 40 to 150 times at greater risk of pneumonia. We all know and have a concern about the percentage of those living in the community with memory disorders and dementia. I've talked to a lot of policymakers, and I find that quite a number of them think that persons with dementia almost all live in nursing homes. And I would gather most of the audience for this webinar is well aware that the majority of persons with dementia, whether it's Alzheimer's or related to dementias, actually live in the community, many of whom live alone. Polypharmacy issues are a concern, since the typical medication usage by just individuals, older persons living in the community, can be 10 to 12 meds a day, different meds a day. And then when we talk about the nursing home or the nursing facility population, it could be anywhere from 12 to 18 to 20. Older persons are also at higher risk in an emergency because of their impairment with activities of daily living. Many are oxygen dependent and dependent on other assistive devices such as wheelchairs, eyeglasses, hearing aids, walkers, canes, especially those with some form of dementia can experience anxiety about leaving their familiar surroundings, although you don't need to have to just be dealing with dementia. One of my favorite stories I tell is about doing a training with an area agency on aging and their staff and clients about emergency preparedness a number of years ago, when we were talking about evacuating to a shelter. And one of the AAA staffers said that if anybody came on my, quote, granny on the hills property, close quote, she would shoot them. And I don't know how many of you come from states with a large rural population, but in Kentucky, I would take that very seriously because it could well happen. So it's not just persons with dementia, but persons who view their independence as primary to everything else, even in a disaster. Older persons experience decreased rebound after an emergency. And there's a belief that they're more resilient in terms of mental health response to an emergency. However, we have found that from 6 to 18 months after an emergency, they are most vulnerable to the symptoms, to evidencing the symptoms of PTSD. The long-term data out 5 years looks solid compared to other survivors in an emergency, younger ones, and the immediate survivors of a disaster. Data looks comparable to the general population, but that 6 to 18 month time frame seems to be an under researched category and a very vulnerable category. And then we obviously have to deal with language and cultural influences. California has an Office for Access and Functional Needs, which is has a tremendous amount of resources, and I've listed their website at the end of the presentation. Their definition basically deals with those who are experiencing issues with maintaining their independence, communication, transportation, supervision, and/or medical care. In addition, it includes those living in institutionalized settings, older adults, children, the diversity of cultures, language issues, where English is their second language, not their first language, and we're back to transportation disadvantaged. If we look at these new definitions, the National Council on Disabilities traditionally has had a narrow definition of disability, and the disabilities community sued the ADA applied the ADA guidelines, and the lawsuit went in terms of sheltering, where historically persons with functional needs may have been disallowed in community shelters. And that lawsuit went all the way to the Supreme Court, and the Supreme Court ruled on the side of the ADA and the disability community. And we now have expanded definitions for disability, similar to what Kentucky and California have done, and the CDC and the Department for Homeland Security and FEMA. The term now also applies to people with heart disease, emotional or psychiatric conditions, arthritis, significant allergies, asthma, chemical sensitivity, respiratory conditions, visual, hearing, and cognitive disabilities. Finally, when the needs of people with disabilities and others with access and functional needs are included and accommodated in planning and services, approximately 50% of the older population would fall under those definitions. I think that's a staggering number. And for those of you on the webinar, I'll just be honest about my age. I'm over 65, and I have arthritis, significant allergies. I can go into asthma. I wear eyeglasses, and I'm almost deaf in one ear. So technically, I could be a functional and access need category. However, the ability to physically function and get around, to cognitively function, take care of myself, and to respond in an appropriate way creates a resilience. And one of the things, as we talk about fan populations, the emphasis so often is on the negative side of who falls under those definitions, and not on the positive side of those over 65 who are still mobile and capable of functioning, and yet certainly fall into the category of what could historically be functional and access needs. And I think it creates a dilemma for policymakers and create an opportunity for bias. And I think for older persons, it's important to be able to address both their resilience as well as some of the impairments to functioning like a 25-year-old. The implications of the new definitions are that it expands those who are covered for ADA compliance in a disaster. As I said, it can apply to over half of the older population, and it certainly has changed the perspective of community sheltering. It has resulted in a shift away from three categories of shelters, where we used to talk about community shelters, special needs shelters, and medical needs shelters. And as a result of the lawsuit, And the Supreme Court ruling, we now generally talk about community sheltering and medical needs sheltering. The Red Cross has committed to incorporating supports and networks of supports to be able to meet the ADA compliance in community shelters. Nevertheless, I think if we stick to a tight definition, we will have an equivalent burden on medical needs shelters by eliminated special needs shelters. So I will not be surprised, given my experience, if we go back to some category of special needs shelter to cover those that don't necessarily have medical needs, and yet their needs cannot be met in a general community shelter. This also places greater responsibilities on community shelter operators, including the American Red Cross, and also, we don't talk about this enough, on those faith-based or mom-and-pop shelter operators, who, again, from I'm in a rural state, we have many mom-and-pops and many faith-based shelter operators who may necessarily not necessarily be informed about ADA compliance. And so there is a potential risk and potential liability for informal shelter operators who have not yet gotten the message that things have changed. Other implications of the new definitions are that we now have a greater need for a wider variety of partners. Red Cross shelters will need lots of partnerships within the shelters that they may not have needed in the past. That means community-based agencies. And at the same time, persons living in the community who are sheltering in place are also going to want access to their agency partners or their contractors. And state and local responders also are going to need those same partners. So I think it is an expectation for us to have that there's going to be as much a duplication of emphasis by every response agency and planning agency to go after the same partners, similar to what we talk about with nursing facilities in a region or a county or even a state who all have the same ambulance services and MOUs with the same water vendors and food vendors and medication vendors. It also, the definitions also create a greater need for shelter in place planning. Because if everybody were to go to a community shelter with over half of those in a shelter being older persons falling under a functional and access needs definition, it raises the issue of who's going to take care of everybody else. Or as the Red Cross might say, who's going to take care of the functional and access needs population in that shelter. So the more we can focus on neighborhood planning and driving our functional and access needs plan to location-based and site-based planning, the more resilient the individuals will be, the neighborhoods will be, and therefore the communities will be. Who are the most at-risk older persons? Well, number one, I would say long-term care residents, followed by persons living in assisted living, persons living in underserved neighborhoods. And I want to focus this afternoon on these last two bullets because I believe they are very under-recognized in terms of at-risk. And those are persons living in HUD-assisted housing under the 202 and 811 programs and persons receiving Medicaid 1915 waivers, which are the waivers to try and keep them in their homes by providing long-term services to avoid having them go to a nursing facility. So we now have area agencies on aging in some places talking about providing long-term care services similar to nursing homes under the 1915 waivers. And yet they're living in the community, many of whom are isolated and don't have family near and don't communicate on a regular basis with their neighbors. And only in a disaster might we find out who those folks are. This is a map of the Medicaid waiver program for the home and community-based services. You can find this map, it's interactive, at the Kaiser Family Foundation website. And the different colors obviously represent the size of the population in each state receiving those waivers. And this population is growing and will continue to grow as the congressional focus and the administration's focus is to keep people out of nursing homes. So we're keeping them at home. Under 1915, these waivers are one of many options available to states to allow the provision of long-term care services in home and community-based settings. These services include case management, homemaker services, home health aides services, personal care delivered in the home, adult day health services, the AAA funding, and some through the 1915 funding. And then day and residential daycare services that are non-medical, as well as respite care. States can also propose other types of services that may assist in diverting and or transitioning individuals from institutional settings back into their homes. This is a slide of the growth of this program. And the different colors represent the different programs. If you look at the lightest blue, those are the 1915 waivers. And you can see that just since 2002 to 2011, there was an increase of more than 100% in funding of those waivers. This is a slide that represents those enrollees in the home and community-based waiver program. The aged and disabled represent 709,000 enrollees, or virtually half of total enrollees. You can see on that slide, however, that persons with intellectual and developmental disabilities receive over 20 times the amount of funding and access to resources as a result of that. That's not a statement of who's more worthy. It's a statement simply about dollars of expenditures. 49% of HCBS recipients are over 65. 40% are represented by the intellectual and developmentally disabled population. Some of those are over 65. Then we have 6% represented by those with physical disabilities and 5% children and others. So we can see the bulge and the increasing bulge in the numbers and dollar amounts of those waivers. And again, these are folks who tend to be isolated, living in the community without family attached. With the HUD-funded programs, 202 and 811, these are assisted housing programs specifically for persons over 65, as well as persons with disability and or substance abuse issues. And oftentimes we see 202 and 811 programs housed in the same property. And you can imagine what that environment may be like and some of the stressors that puts on the older population living in HUD housing. There are almost 400,000 units across the U.S. and most of these units are multi-story, multi-family units. They're means tested. Eligibility is means tested for many at significant levels below poverty, with many at 200% below poverty. I think the average income for the 202 population is approximately $9,500. They have a greater average annual length of stay. They may stay 7 to 8 years in a property. Older persons move in to stay, while younger persons, now we're talking under 50 is younger, move in to move on. And in a presentation I gave in Kentucky to multifamily unit managers, what they reported is many people move in ambulatory, and after 5 or 6 years, they're now non-ambulatory. They're oxygen dependent, and they are using any number of other medical devices to maintain their quality of life in the facility. And the HUD owner operators are property owners. They aren't service providers. So the 202 and 811 program tenants are that. They are tenants. Comorbidity is commonplace. Obesity and bariatric tenants are an issue. These buildings most often include elevators because they're high rises in many locations. And HUD does not require or offer guidance on tenant preparedness. HUD, up till Hurricane Sandy, had focused on property preparedness, because what they do is offer loans to the property developers, who then rent to 202 and 811 eligible older persons. So this is a population that is consolidated in place. During Hurricane Sandy, what we found was when the power goes out and you're a 20-story building of 202 and 811 tenants, you have to, the Red Cross finally figured out that you need to take the services to them. So they would set up a shelter at the curb, and then they would work with first responders to literally carry up the food, carry up the medicines, carry up the supplies. In that presentation I did a number of years ago, there were maybe 200 managers in the room, and I asked them how many of their properties had emergency plans, and approximately 10 out of 200 had emergency plans that weren't just about the property. And when I asked how many had evacuation plans, only 2 out of 200 had evacuation plans. So this is not only a vulnerable population, under a functional and access needs definition, it's a vulnerable population because they're living in a building that doesn't have preparedness planning. So one of the critical issues with functional and access needs is developing preparedness and response plans. And I know public health has done this over the years. I know that AAAs, the Area Agencies on Aging, have made attempts. Folks need to have an emergency plan in place. And number two, share it with others. That means if you receive Medicaid waiver services, make sure that you've got a copy on the refrigerator, magnetized to the refrigerator, and any service provider who comes in the building knows where that is, as well as family members know what your plan is and neighbors know what your plan is. And hopefully they're all in your plan. Individuals need a personal support network in place. They need to have in their plans for contacting others who can respond and who can think for them in many situations. They need to practice, and the family needs to practice the plan and make regular revisions to the plan. If you're a functional older adult, one way to get educated and get involved is to be part of your CERT team in your community. If you're a retired healthcare worker, join your MRC, your Medical Reserve Corps. Volunteer for the Red Cross. There are lots of ways that functional older persons can get involved to then help the vulnerable older persons in their neighborhood or in their community. It's really important to have an awareness of what the community's plans are, to know where functional and access needs populations, especially in your neighborhood, fall in your county emergency operations plan, and to participate in community exercises. And you can see in bold there, I say easier said than done for every single bullet on that list. Oftentimes, the fan population are folks who don't want to depend on others. The fact that they may need to is enough dependency for them, and they feel that they don't deserve it, or they want to stay and protect their property. So this is a challenge just to deal with personal preparedness planning. How do they make a decision to shelter in place, since that is the safest option, whether you're living in the community or whether you're living in assisted living or in a long-term care facility? What's the decision-making going to be? Hopefully, the person who qualifies under the FAN definition has other interested parties in their network who can help them think through the planning. And if they can't help them think through, then hopefully they may have access to actual plans. Key elements in a shelter-in-place plan include having supplies and equipment for 3 to 7 days. What we have found with older persons is if they have that supply, it needs to be checked on a regular basis because they have run out of food or water and have used up their backup supply. So at least once a month, that backup supply needs to be checked. Caregiving supports need to be available and accessible and identified, number one. And then agreements need to be in place in neighborhoods or among populations to get supplies, equipment, and or services for home. And then in an evacuation plan, to have a kit in the vehicle, to have a go bag in the fan population individual's apartment, to know who to notify if you're going to evacuate, what you need, when to go, where to go, and how to get there. And that's daunting for people who don't have any functional and access needs. So we're asking a lot of vulnerable populations. Critical issues at the agency level are to have a risk assessment for agencies to know what the main hazards that they're vulnerable to would be so that their emergency plan is in response to that, to be involved in the community's plan, to have MOAs with multiple vendors, to certainly have a shelter-in-place plan, an evacuation plan, and to have a plan for staff and how staff will contact their clients and be able to support clients' needs, whether they're in a shelter or whether they're at home. Mutual aid agreements are critical, especially for agencies or clusters of populations. And these are some bullets with some key items to keep in mind. What agencies need to know is the role of state and local planning, because each state and county have to have their own all hazards emergency operations plan, and they should have protocols and procedures now for functional and access needs individuals. What agencies need to know, who the state government players are, your state emergency management agency falls under the auspices of the governor. Your Department for Public Health falls under ESF-8, which is responsible for hospital and health care and the well-being of persons in that state, as well as other agencies within state government. And then the State Department for Homeland Security addresses security issues with state and federal organizations. In an emergency, your Division of Emergency Management at the state level has the authority to represent the governor in all matters related to a comprehensive emergency management program. They tend to manage the State Emergency Operations Center. They're in charge of the State Emergency Operations Plan. And in Kentucky, they're part of the Department for Military Affairs. But if you're wanting to know more about functional and access needs response, the number one directive is to find out where your state organization, how in that flow chart, the organization chart for your state, where emergency management lies. And that's at the state level. At the local level, emergency managers are political appointees. They're not part of the state structure. There are regional emergency managers who are part of the state structure, and they're responsible for multiple counties. But at the county level, that's your mayor or county judge who basically assigns your emergency manager. And they can be full-time, they can be part-time, they can be volunteer. They can have lots of experience in emergency management. They can have no experience in emergency management. So if you're on a planning coalition or in an agency or part of a group that's trying to plan for functional and access needs, you definitely want to know your county emergency manager, and I would be sure to incorporate them in your planning. I'm just going to move on. Reasonable expectations of local government. Local roles include rescue and treatment, law enforcement, protection and restoration of critical infrastructure, sheltering, managing resources. In a disaster, local government's role is not to go out and take care of individual persons with functional and access needs. That is more a public health role. Local government and your local emergency manager's role is to manage the disaster, not to manage coverage of functional and access needs. That is another reason why we need more of a coordinated effort to prepare and have a response network for functional and access needs populations. This all fits into community resilience. And I liked this presentation a lot. It was first developed by the RAND Corporation, and I found it in an article which is cited at the bottom. The critical levers of community resilience for FAN populations, from our vantage point, is education, engagement, and self-sufficiency. Partnerships are critical. But getting the message out, educating functional and access needs populations about their responsibilities to have a plan, to have a network, to engage with others in that, to number one, take care of their self-sufficiency. And if they don't have self-sufficiency, to identify who the primary service agencies are that are providing that or supporting that. In their communities and in their neighborhoods, and to bring those partners, those service agencies together to create strong partnerships. These occur at the state level as well, and numbers of states have ongoing functional coalitions that are addressing this. In Kentucky, we have a separate Kentucky Functional and Access Needs Collaborative. There are local and regional coalitions, whether it's through your functional and access needs group, your hospital or healthcare preparedness program, your local emergency preparedness coalitions. We have found that using block watch groups at a micro level within a neighborhood has worked to expand their focus from block watch to knowing exactly who the older and vulnerable persons are in their blocks, and have a network of persons to respond and to check on them during an emergency. The AAA of Southern Utah has a great handout of a preparedness buddy. I tried to get that into this presentation and was unsuccessful with the scanning process. But if you go to the Area Agency on Aging of Southern Utah, you can get a copy of that. The National Council on Disabilities has resources. Area Agencies on Aging are the primary entity that works with those waivers, the 1519 waivers or 1915 waivers. And I encourage you to engage your regional and state Area Agencies on Aging and Department on Aging. The Alzheimer's Association has some great resources. They also have regional representation who can assist on a coalition, be effective on a coalition. Your key advocacy groups would include the visually impaired, the hearing impaired, the disability community, as well as your aging partners. And then your representatives from the Department for Homeland Security at the state or local level. Public health challenges fall under engagement. How do we get people involved? Is the diversity of the neighborhood represented in the efforts to get involved? You want neighborhood leadership. Folks over 65 tend to recoil when somebody walks in and says, I'm from the state or county and I'm here to help. You definitely want a face of local leadership, whether it's a health navigator or just a volunteer to get this started. Creating neighborhood groups who can then have representation in county coalitions could go a long way to addressing community resilience for older persons and a network for those folks. Emergency communications method. Most communities have a local 211 or 911 equivalent. One of the things the research from Hurricane Sandy found was persons over 65, especially falling under a functional and access needs umbrella, rely on TV and radio. Don't send them internet messages and resources over the internet, because a lot of the people, the majority of people who we're talking about with functional and access needs are not going to necessarily be computer literate, have access to a computer, know where the library is, have transportation to a library, much less be literate. So TV and radio are the primary mode of communication to emergency communication for that population. Talked about engagement of advocacy groups and then retention, how to keep groups and persons engaged in these efforts. And the best way to do that is to have ongoing exercises. Do a communication exercise with the group, with the coalition, within a neighborhood, with a block watch. Create some scenarios and have tabletops with these people. Include pizza on the menu. Have them over for dinner in a community center. keep the scenarios going so people get practice under different sets of circumstances. The scenarios don't have to be large. In fact, it's better if they're targeted and small in scope, because it's going to help identify what the smallest elements of the barriers are in the response needs. I've listed groups of resources for you. It could go on and on. I ran out of time, honestly, in the preparation. Here's my contact information. I'm happy to answer any quick questions. And I will sign off now. Thanks.
We'll now open the floor to questions for Betty. Our first question, Betty, is from Marilyn. And she asks, I work as a service coordinator in HUD, HUD, Affordable Housing.
Wow.
This is the first time I have heard the risks involved. And she actually is just making a comment saying that's the first time she's seen it. She's seen the whole issue addressed so cogently.
Let me respond to that comment, if you will. I am so happy to have somebody on the webinar from HUD. I have been concerned about this population for years, and even in our rural communities, we have some HUD properties that are 14 stories, and the police force is small, the county response network is small, and without planning in these locations for tenant safety, the stress is on the responder network and on the resources at the county level could be paralyzing. So thank you for spending your time being on the webinar.
Hello, this is Malin McBride.
Hi, Malin.
Betty, thank you again very much for your presentation. This is brings it to a lot of reality for people from different agencies. And thank you, Betty, for your great talk. And thank you, Jack and Marianne. And thank you especially for those who were able to join us today.